I think there's, if you look at the panel, we have quite a few investors in this space. And I'm going to go to the other end of the panel to, I think, provide some balance and discussion around the impact of transportation projects in countries. So we have with us the Honorable James Macharia. He's the Acting Cabinet Secretary, Ministry of Transport and Infrastructure in Kenya, also a good friend. And Honorable Macharia, maybe you can talk a little bit about what's going on in Kenya and what are the positives of the impact of some of these projects?
Thank you very much, Thomas. I think before I do so, let me say that as a participant, I found this session extremely, extremely valuable. You know, let me thank the organizers of this event, because as a government minister, you know, sitting here, I've seen a lot of positives, a lot of value, you know, and indeed I was just saying that I feel like it's like a day in office or a day in cabinet, because some conferences you go to and people give, you know, speeches day in, day out, you know, but this one, let me say, it has given us very tangible deliverables. I feel that this one day, personally, I'll leave this place with a lot of, you know, value, which makes it indeed justifiable to have come all this way. So I'd like to thank the organizers for this. Let me also say that as a government minister, you know, what I can really say is the kind of impact these regional projects, you know, have on governments and countries. I know individual officers have talked about individual projects, individual, you know, deals which have happened, transactions. But to me, I can just summarize in terms of the impact these regional projects are having. And I emphasize regional because I don't think in Africa there are many deals which are big enough within individual countries. I think we even heard from our colleague from Netherlands. He said that even in Europe, there's not a single big project within the country itself. And so for Africa, it's even more prominent and more important to look at these deals on a transborder basis. In terms of the impact, you know, to me, I have to look at it in terms of GDP. And some of the projects which have been discussed today, like Kasuku today discussed about LAPSET. That particular project, the impact on GDP, initially it will be about 3%. By the time it's completed, it will go to up to 7%. One project alone, you know, having an impact of 7% on GDP. So as a country, we have to have extreme value. We have to have extreme focus to make sure that these projects actually do succeed. Secondly, these kind of projects, they open up, you know, areas which are marginalized. You find, for example, if you take the two big projects in Kenya, which is Lamu Port, South Sudan, Ethiopia Transit Corridor. It goes across many countries. Some of the areas they do pass, they are very marginalized. And that's why you hear sometimes there are security issues in Kenya. Because some of those areas are marginalized, they never seen development, and as a result, you find that there's a lot of insecurity. We believe with this kind of projects, it will open up these areas and make sure that those who get employed, they get busy, and some of the issues we had in the past about security, they do go away. The other major issue, major impact is about these kind of projects have multi-sectoral impact. You find, for example, that railway which Thomas was talking about, it actually touches on about 7 ministries. So as a government, it helps to consolidate the way we operate. You know, 7 ministries, you know, environment, lands, attorney general, you know, name it. We are all part of this SGR, almost half of the cabinet. So it helps a lot in terms of consolidation, the way we do things. Then, even more important, it helps us create this kind of dialogue with the private sector. And that's why we are here today. If we didn't have this kind of projects, there would be no opportunity to discuss us as government, as you, as a private sector. That, and possibly most important, if you look at some of the areas they go through, they have gone through geopolitical instability. The Horn of Africa, you know about Southern Sudan, you know, other areas which, as you know, historically have had issues. I think by opening up and making sure that you have these projects which touch on each country, even countries which are landlocked, they see themselves having opportunity to deal with the outside world. You know, in the Horn of Africa, for example, some countries have gone to war. I think it was Eritrea and Ethiopia, just to have access to the sea. Now, to have this project which Kasuku mentioned, which is Lapset, it touches on Lamu Port, but go through countries which were previously landlocked. And therefore, those countries now can see themselves having an interface with the global community. And therefore, it helps to ease tensions and help in terms of making sure that these countries in these regions remain united and peaceful. Lastly, but not least, because of the size of these projects, it allows large investors like yourselves to come to the table. If you have small projects, the likes of General Electric, where Thomas works, you won't be interested in coming to East Africa. These big sovereign funds will not be interested. But if we have these regional projects which cover, say, 2, 3, 4 countries, then those economies of scale allow large investors like yourself to come on board. And therefore, we really have to emphasize regional approach, whether it's in the transport sector, energy sector, ICT, even health sector. Because one thing I didn't say is that whereas I'm acting cabinet secretary, cabinet minister for transport and infrastructure, I'm actually the substantive minister for health. And because of the kind of projects we have in all sectors in the country, you find that the larger they are, the likelihood we have of bringing on board large investors like yourself. Let me close by saying there are a few projects which I need to mention, which may be of interest to you. I think Kasuku did talk about Lapset, which I think he explained in detail. We also have what we call the Roads Annuity Program. What we realize as a country is that if we are to do our roads, we shall not be able to do it in the next 2 or 3 decades. Number one, because we don't have the money. We calculated and said if you have to do 10,000 kilometers, which is our goal in the next 5 years, we require about $30 billion, which we don't have. But the private sector, the private funds, pension funds, that money is out there. We have told our pension funds back home, we do not want them to do, we want them to stop doing skyscrapers, because that's not their business. That's the business of private sector investors. We want them to invest in infrastructure projects, because that's what gives a country a long-term sustained development. And so for you, I would like to welcome you to this program, which we call a Annuity Program. And what it is, without going into too much detail, is that we like the roads construction to be transferred to the private sector. We set up a fund through this annuity where we shall put money to guarantee or to hedge your investment. And if you come, you find that you do the design, you do the maintenance. As a result, you can factor a profit margin over and above the normal rates which are charged by contractors. And with that, I think we have a very, very strong business model to work together as partners.
Thank you, Honorable CS. And I think for the crowd to also know, or for this audience to know, the Honorable Cabinet Secretary is also masquerading because he's a former banker. So all of the investment discussions around transportation and health are really tinged with a solid financial model that it really helps to have that mindset in when dealing with those projects. So thank you very much.
Doing business in Africa, you can't afford to be without Africa Investor.